Hello everyone, welcome to our third video lecture on transducers for the measurements and instrumentation course. It's been a long time since we met in a classroom environment. Let's pray God so that he helps us to fight out this deadly virus and get back to our work soon. How are you all? Logesh, Vishnu, Naveen, the projector man Srinath, Deepak, Nikhil, Arthian, Surya, Santosh, Pugalendi, Anthony, Namasivaya, Logeshwaran, Satyasilan, Jabahar, Suramanjari, Anchana, Kausalya, Priyadarshini, Bhavana, Jos, Subhashini, Lakshya, Maheshwari, Navina Sri, Netra, Sindhu, Saraswati. Hope I missed many of the other pearls names. Hope everybody is fine. Take care of yourself and your family. Try to explore more about yourself by exhibiting some of your good stuffs while you stay in home. Do keep your learning. Continue that. And in this learning video, we'll discuss on the working of a capacitive and inductive transducer. Okay, let's get into the video. This is CO5 of Unit 5. We have completed the classifications of transducer, and in the last class we have covered the resistive transducer. Today we will discuss about the inductive and capacitive transducer. Before that, a review of previous session. We discussed about the function of transducer, classifications of transducer based on different categories, power source, conversion principle, working principle. And then transduction principle includes resistive, inductive and capacitive. And we have completed this discussion on resistive transducer with RTD. I have posted a self-assessment for the learning of the previous session. And let us share the answers for the self-assessment. The first question: the element or device that converts one physical parameter into another physical parameter. Answer is sensor. Thermistor is an example for sensing element. Piezoelectric crystal is an example for transducer because the piezoelectric crystal output is electrical, hence the answer is transducer. Identify the primary sensing element from the following options. Bodon tube and diaphragm are the sensing element. LVDT is a transducer. So bodon tube and diaphragm are the sensing element. So answer A and C are correct. Identify the transduction device from the options. Transduction device, the output should be electrical. So potentiometer and thermocouple are the transduction devices. So answer is B and C. RTD has negative temperature coefficient of resistance. No, answer is false because RTD has positive temperature coefficient of resistance. PT100 in RTD stands for 100 ohms resistance at 0 degree Celsius. Identify the active transducer. Answer is thermocouple. Identify the inverse transducer. Answer is piezoelectric. Identify the non-resistive transducer. RTD, potentiometer, thermistor, all are resistive. So the answer is LVDT. Let us go back to the presentation for discussing the today's lecture, that is on capacitive and inductive transducer. Capacitive transducer, how does it functions? Capacitive transducer is a passive transducer. It is used to measure displacement, liquid level, pressure and humidity in gases. Passive transducer means this transducer requires a power supply for its operation. Capacitive transducer requires power supply for its operation, hence it is a passive transducer. but it is used to measure displacement. How? Because it uses the electrical quantity of capacitance for converting mechanical moment into electric signal. We know a transducer converts physical quantity into electrical quantity. Here, the mechanical moment, which is the physical quantity, is first converted into capacitance and then converted into electric signal. So in capacitive transducer, there are two stages. One is the mechanical moment is first converted into capacitance, and then this capacitance is converted into electric signal. How does that happen? So you'll see. The construction of capacitive transducer, it is actually similar to a capacitor, wherein a capacitor has two plates and in between dielectric material. So two metal plates, top plate, bottom plate, in between we have dielectric material. This schematic depicts the construction of a capacitive transducer. But it is different from capacitor, because in capacitor the plate's position cannot be changed. But here in capacitive transducer, the movement of this plate can be done. And that is the difference between the capacitive transducer and a normal capacitor. The position of these plates can be varied in a capacitive transducer. And also the intensity of this dielectric medium changes in a capacitive transducer. And you are seeing two construction types of a capacitive transducer. One is a cylindrical type and another one is rectangular planes. We'll take these rectangular plates. You see, one is a fixed plate and another one is a movable plate. When we apply displacement to this movable plate, this plate moves over the fixed plate. And there is an area which is overlapped between the fixed plate and movable plate. When we apply displacement and when this movable plate moves, the overlapping area between the fixed plate and the moving plate changes. This in turn changes the capacitance. That is governed by this equation. Capacitance equals epsilon naught epsilon r into overlapping area slash distance between the plates. So when we apply displacement, the movable plate, it moves over the fixed plate and the overlapping area changes. The overlapping area changes, hence capacitance changes. And this is how the mechanical moment, physical quantity, is converted into capacitance. This capacitance changes based on three factors. One is this overlapping area and the distance between the plates and the dielectric medium. We can also vary the distance between the two plates. For example, we fix one plate and we move another plate up or down. Thereby, we actually change the distance between the plates. If we change the distance between the plates, that also changes the capacitance. We can also change the dielectric medium. The intensity of the dielectric medium can be changed to change the capacitance. So this is the first stage in the conversion of capacitive transducer. A mechanical moment is converted into capacitor. And this capacitance, if it is connected in a AC bridge circuit like Wien bridge circuit, we get electric potential. We know Wien bridge circuit is used to measure frequency in AC circuit. We connect this capacitance to one of the four arms of the Wien bridge, and that Wien bridge gives electric potential. And this is how this capacitance is converted into electric output. So mechanical moment, displacement converted into capacitance using this equation as overlapping area or distance between the plates or dielectric medium, and that capacitance connected in a Wien's bridge circuit gives electric potential. And let us discuss an application of this capacitive transducer for the liquid level measurement. The image depicts how the capacitive transducer is constructed for the purpose. You are actually seeing a tank which contains a metal rod, and the wall of the tank is made up of metal. So we have two metal plates here. One is the metal rod and the tank wall. And we apply voltage across these two plates and they become electrodes. So this metal rod may become a positive plate anode, and this tank wall may become a negative plate cathode. So this tank actually depicts the construction of a capacitive transducer wherein we have two electrodes. And the medium, whatever exists in between these two electrodes, will become the dielectric medium. Hence, if the liquid level increases, then the intensity of the dielectric medium also increases. This in turn increases the capacitance and thereby increasing the electric output obtained from the Weinrich circuit. So the final electrical output is actually a measure of liquid level of this tank. So in this way, capacitive transducer can be used to measure the liquid level of the tank. In case if the liquid is a conducting liquid, then an insulation provided on this metal rod will become the dielectric medium. Hence, if the liquid level increases, it actually increases the overlapping area between the two metal plates. So this conducting liquid ensures the overlapping area between the two metal plates. So overlapping area increases, which in turn increases the capacitance, thereby the electric output also increases. So this means the capacitive transducer can be used to measure both the level of non-conductive as well as conductive liquids. So this YouTube video explains this application with a good animation. You can watch this video and come back to the presentation. Let's come back to the presentation. Advantages of capacitive transducer. It requires small forces to operate. Has good frequency response as it is used in AC circuit. The frequency response is as high as 50 kHz, hence useful in dynamic studies where the parameters are changing rapidly. It provides high resolution and hence extremely sensitive. Applied where stray magnetic fields render inductive transducer useless. This means inductive transducer uses magnetic induction principle. This stray magnetic field is nothing but the external magnetic field which may interfere with the system magnetic field of the inductive transducer, and that will make the inductive transducer useless. And so in those situations, this capacitive transducer can be used, which is independent of the effect of this external magnetic field. Next, inductive transducer. We have considered LVDT as an inductive transducer, which is linear variable differential transformer. This is also a passive transducer used to translate a linear motion into electric signal. It can also be used to translate angular motions into electric signal. Basically, LVDT is used to convert motions into electric signal. And this image shows the construction of LVDT. So you are actually seeing a cylinder. This is a cylindrical chamber, and this cylindrical chamber contains one primary winding and two secondary windings. These two secondary windings are connected in series with each other but in opposition. That means if secondary winding 1 is connected in anti-clockwise direction, then secondary winding 2 may be connected in clockwise direction. So that is called connected in opposition. So secondary winding 1 and secondary winding 2 are connected in series opposition. So this opposition connection is done to ensure this null position of this LVDT. We will see what it is later. And here you have a soft iron core which moves inside the cylindrical chamber. We have four lead wires coming out of this LVDT, and two lead wires are actually used to give the alternating current power supply to LVDT, and two lead wires are used to take the output of the LVDT. And this first diagram shows the connections. You are seeing these two lead wires gives the alternating current power supply to this primary winding coil. And you see the secondary winding coils, both are connected in series. They are connected in series and output is taken from the secondary winding. So alternating current power supply is supplied to the primary winding, and you have two secondary windings, and the net output voltage is actually the difference between the two secondary winding voltages. And how voltages are induced, you will see. So it works based on the principle of mutual inductance. Okay, let us see how this happens. So we apply alternating current to this primary winding, and this coil becomes electromagnet, and magnetic field is induced in the primary winding. And the iron core present inside the cylinder will induce this magnetic field onto the two secondary windings. Hence, if the core is on the center of the cylinder, then the magnetic field induced on the secondary winding 1 and secondary winding 2 will be equal. So, core induces equal magnetic field on secondary winding 1 and secondary winding 2 if the core is on the center of the cylinder. Hence, EMF induced on the secondary winding 1 will be equal to the EMF induced on the secondary winding 2. So, EMF induced on secondary winding 1 equals EMF induced in secondary winding 2. Hence, the net output voltage of this LVDT is 0. This is called a null position in LVDT. And this is possible only if these two secondary windings are connected in series opposition. And this is why they are connected in series opposition, to ensure null position in LVDT. And if the core is at the left side of the cylinder like this, then it induces more magnetic field on the secondary winding than on the secondary winding 2. So that means this core induces more magnetic flux on the secondary winding 1. Hence, more EMF is induced in secondary winding 1 when compared with the EMF induced in the secondary winding 2. Hence, secondary winding EMF 1 is greater than the secondary winding EMF 2. Hence, the output voltage is positive. In case if the core is on the right side of this cylinder, it means it induces more magnetic field on the secondary winding 2. Hence, more EMF on the secondary winding 2. Hence, the output voltage will be negative. This means LVDT can be used to measure both positive as well as negative outputs. Advantages of LVDT. The characteristics of LVDT is linear. It has high sensitivity. The maximum output is about 40 volt per millimeter. Imagine how high it is, 40 volt per millimeter. So that's why it does not need any amplification. And it consumes less power also. Used on high frequencies up to 20 kilohertz. Of course, not high as that of the capacitive transducer. Okay, we come to the end of the presentation. A quick summary. So we reviewed the previous session contents and discussed the answers for the previous self-assessment and explained the constructions and working of capacitive and inductive transducer. So this completes our today's session. So we have a self-assessment which I will post you through online portal later. Thank you for your patient listening. We'll meet in the next video. Until then, it's bye from Dr. Balaji Madhavan.